We're going to be in Isaiah chapter 40, and we will read verses 29 through 31 before we get started. Word of the Lord. I titled this morning's message, Wings for the Weary. And in this first couple of verses that we're going to read regarding this particular chapter, I would say that this is the promise that God is giving to His people in this particular passage. The Word of God says that He gives power to the faint, and to them that have no might, He increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not be faint. If we go back to the beginning of the chapter that starts this, I would probably say that what's worded in here is it kind of gives us an idea of the problem, or at least the previous problem, all right? And the previous problem, which tells us why God's even given them a promise to begin with, says right here in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 2. Isaiah 40, verses 1 through 2 says, "Comfort ye. Comfort ye, my people, says your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins." So this was the previous problem for God's people, but yet in the end of the chapter, He's given them a promise. A lot of times I like to try to give people some underlying context of the particular passage or where we are in the Bible. I like to use timelines a lot of times because I think that it helps us just to understand the Bible better whenever we can see where we are in the passage of Scripture. Many times I start off really with the fall, and the only reason I do that is not that I'm constantly wanting to be reminded of sin or sin conscience, you know, and, you know, a lot of people have preached messages, even in the Word of Faith movement. Oh, you don't want to think about sin. No, we need to know about sin. We need to be aware of sin because sin prevents us from having access to the presence of God. What we need to understand is that it's after the fall that God began to give a plan that would remedy the problem of sin. And the problem, what He showed us the remedy was, even in the garden, was when He clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of that innocent animal, which was a picture and a type of the cross, that would say the shedding of Jesus' blood, which was innocent, was going to be the way that we would have freedom from our guilt and pain. Whenever we move from the flood, from the fall, I would probably say the next big event was the flood. Then after that, there was the Tower of Babel. After the flood, man, here at the fall, man as an individual sinned against God. But at the Tower of Babel, what we see is that man corporately is sinning against God. Man, in general, that there, we begin to get a glimpse at the Tower of Babel that there's a spirit on the earth, a spirit of disobedience. It comes from the evil one, the enemy of God, and it's pushing mankind in an opposite direction of the will of God. God's will is that man, the created human being that we are, understand that He is sovereign, He is real, and He wants to have a relationship with us. But the spirit of disobedience that comes from the enemy, the Word of God says in Ephesians 2, it calls Him the prince of the power of the air. And it talks about the fact that He is the spirit that works in the children of disobedience. But what I'm just trying to explain to you right here, because this is still pervasive today in the land that we live in, that there's a spirit, that there's a plan of the enemy. It's much more orchestrated and organized than what we would have ever imagined, and that it is moving humanity, really like a herd of cattle, in a particular direction which is opposite of the plan of God, the pathway that God would have His people, that would choose Him to be His God, trying to move all of humanity in an opposite direction. Now, the truth be told, that there's many human beings that don't even want to be the people of God. They don't believe the Word of God. But even the people of God, the enemy, wants to move them in that opposite direction. Now, what's so beautiful to me is that when you turn the page from chapter 11 to chapter 12, then what you see here is a promise that God gave to Abraham. And the reason that it's so beautiful to me is because whenever you begin to see the Scripture this way, it just unfolds the truth of how real God is, at least to me it does that. It solidifies in my heart and in my mind that no matter what it is that I'm going through, I'm here to tell you that God is real. And while I can't see it with my physical eyes, I'm telling you, one day we will see him. And at that point in time, it's all going to be revealed. And the reason I say that is because when he confused the languages, he spread the people out. But when you turn the page, God said, I'm going to make a nation out of you. God created a nation for himself from this one man, Abraham. And he called him out, and from Abraham, there was a succession of births that took place. But God had the promised son, which was Isaac. And Isaac had two sons, but the main one that we want to talk about is Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, which became the 12 tribes, and Jacob's name was changed to Israel. That's where the name Israel came from. So the 12 sons of Jacob became the 12 tribes of Israel, which swelled to become a nation while they became slaves in Egypt, if you'll remember that story. And God delivered them out from Egypt with the power of the Passover. What happened on the Passover night is another type of the cross. God said, take that lamb, another innocent lamb that had nothing to do with the sin of Adam and Eve, which now has come upon the entirety of the human race and has ultimately led to bondage, which is a type of many times of even the children of God. When they find themselves in disobedience towards God, they will find themselves in bondage. On that Passover night, God said, you take that lamb, you slice its throat, you collect its blood, you paint the doorpost and the sidepost with that blood, and my death angel's coming through. Judgment is coming upon the land. Egypt is a type of the world. Egypt is a type of the world in the Old Testament. What you and I need to understand is that judgment will come upon this world. Judgment will come upon this world, but yet God has a plan. And the way his plan is the same today as it was yesterday. The plan is, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Yeah. That's what makes the difference between the Christian and the non-believer. Not because you're better than them, not because you've read more Bible than them, not because you go to church, not because you get dressed up on Sunday. It doesn't have anything to do with that. Not because you're involved in ministry, not because what differentiates you from the world around you is the fact that you heard the gospel and you believe the gospel. Listen to me, if you're looking for perfect people in the church, you need to go find another church. Amen. Because the reality is this, is that we are all part of Adam's fallen race. Amen. And each and every one of us had to hear the gospel, and you might be struggling with one thing, and I might be struggling with another thing, but let it be known, we're all struggling with something, but the Lord is the deliverer of his people. Amen? Amen. And what I need you to know is this, is that the plan is the same, and whenever he sees the blood, he will pass over you. So what makes you different from the world around you is that you heard the gospel, you responded by faith, and when you did, you were declared righteous by God, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of God, and now you're not just the creation of God, but you're the child of God. Amen? Right. And listen, the world can say, oh, but we're all his children. No, we're not. I have conversations with people all the time because I have a secular job too. And in that secular job, I'm able to talk to people about, oh, well, you're talking about Jesus. Oh, well, we're all the children of God. No, ma'am, we're all the creation of God. But we're not all the children of God. Right. You must respond to the gospel by faith. And when you do, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. That makes you different than the world around right. you. When the Holy Ghost comes to live on the inside of your heart, he's living and abiding inside of the hearts of his people. He's not doing that for the world. In the Old Testament, these were God's people. The promise was given to Abraham, and ultimately, through those 12 tribes, they swelled to a great nation, and on the Passover night, they exited the world. A type of the day when you gave your heart to Jesus Christ. You exited the world. It might not have all happened at once, but if you got sealed with the Holy Spirit, if you have been born again, and the Holy Spirit lives in your heart, you can never be the same again. And your exit might be slow, your exit might be fast. That's another thing people want to judge of. Well, when I got saved, I threw it all down in one moment of time. Well, you didn't throw it all down, brother, sister. I can assure you that there's still, well, I'm not going to say what my old pastor used to say because it was kind of gross, but what he used to say, there's still some boogers in your biscuit. I know, that's like, oh, dude, did you really go there? Anyway, there's still some things that the Lord is dealing with and working on. Amen? Amen. And so from that, we see the Exodus. But you exited the world. Amen? You're different. You're a peculiar people. You're a holy nation. You're a royal priesthood. You've been called called to show forth the praises of him that called you out of darkness and into light. Amen. And so we're a different people. Amen. And that was what Israel's purpose was in the Old Testament. They were to be a nation that had God. We even talked about that recently out of the book of Deuteronomy before they were going to enter the promised land. That God gave them the word. Remember, he gave them his judgments and his statutes, which was the law, but it was the word that they had of God. We have the whole Bible now, but they had that portion of the Bible. And God said, you hold on to these statutes and this judgment, for it is your wisdom amongst the nations that I will bring you. And when they see the wisdom that you have, they're going to say, what other nation is there that is this close to their God? Because God has revealed himself to his people through his word. And so he gave them great promises. He told them that if you will follow after me, if you will obey my commandments, then there will be great blessing for you. But if you don't, in Deuteronomy 28, he talks about blessings and curses. He says, if you don't, he said, there's not going to be anything in the storehouse for you. He said, you know, people are going to come in, they're going to come in one way, you're going to flee 1,000 different ways. In other words, fear was going to strike their heart. There was going to be nothing left of the harvest. They were going to be in the midst of famine. They weren't going to have anything that they were going to be able to harvest. They weren't going to have anything that they were going to be able to store up. Sin was going to, if they fell into sin, it was going to riddle their lives. It was going to take away their possessions. It was going to take away the blessing of God's hand upon their lives. And sure enough, as Israel, they wandered in a wilderness, but even once he brought them in. So there was a wilderness experience after the Exodus, but even once he brought them in to the promised land, which was originally named Canaan and was later named Israel because the Canaanite used to live in the land. Once he brought them in, they began to, well, it all started with Solomon. I always have to remind you of that, that even what the Bible calls the wisest man in the world made some grievous sins against God. The Bible says that God originally told the children of Israel not to intermarry with the heathen women of the other nations. And the reason why he didn't want them to do that, and it's very important that we understand that today. We don't have too many young people that might not be married in here today. But at the same time, maybe you're single and maybe one day you will get married or whatever the case. What you need to understand, this is very important that I tell you this. The reason that God told his people that they weren't to marry the world was that the world was going to draw them away to the sacrifices of the other gods and pull their hearts away from him. Now, in a modern vernacular or in the New Testament life of the Christian who is born again and the Holy Spirit lives in their heart, you're the person that you might be seeing or your future boyfriend or whatever the story may be. He may not be bringing you out to the woods like that girl that I used to know that told me, I asked her, what church, what religion are you? You want to make fun of my religion? She said, well, I'm pagan. I'm like, oh, okay, what do y'all do? We go out to the woods and we kill a goat and we eat goat. So it was basically very demonic. But so what my point is that your future boyfriend might not be going out to the woods and killing goats. But what he is, if he hasn't responded to the gospel, become born again, having the Holy Spirit living in his heart, and he's in the world, if he's an Egyptian, if you would allow me to say it that way, and not a Hebrew, then what's going to happen is he's going to pull your heart away from the things of God, and you're going to move further and further and further into the world, and further away from the presence of God. That's why God does not want his people cohabiting in close relationships with those that do not know him. Because those people do not know the ways of God. Their minds have not been renewed to the things of God. They have rejected the counsel of God. And therefore, the things that they involve themselves with, the topics of their conversation, are not of the Lord. They are instead of the world. And if you're around them long enough, it will pull you away instead of bringing you in. I can't tell you the untold misery that people have had because yet they love God. And let me tell you something. If you've truly been born again and the Holy Spirit has come to live on the inside of your heart, you'll never be the same. Amen. Even if you reject God, even if you try to walk away from God, even if you try to go back to your life the way that it was before, I can assure you it will never be the same. You will live a life of misery and sorrow. The things that used to bring you joy and pleasure won't have the same taste that they used to have. And so what ends up happening is that's what happened to Israel. Solomon married those women. He did against what God told him to do. And I mean, he had multiple of those kinds of women. Married him, had concubines for him. I mean, look, what does that mean? It means he had, not only did he have, I can't even remember, I didn't go back and review, several hundred wives, he had several hundred concubines. That means women that he just laid with. And they were all of these false gods. That's what I said, Brother Larry. You ain't no high in the world. Why would you? Yeah, I'm with you, brother. But anyway, that's another story for another time. That's what happened to Solomon. And what happened to Solomon was that they did exactly what God said that they would do. They pulled his heart away from him. What does that mean? That means that he began to build altars for them so that they could serve their gods, sacrifice to their gods. When God saw that, he became very angry. He told Solomon, because of your sin, the kingdom is going to be split in two. So from that time moving forward, the nation, both the northern part of the kingdom, which was Israel, and the southern part, which was Judah, began to fall into idolatrous habits, practices, where they began to intermingle with the world. Basically, it would be kind of like in today's society, the Christian that shows up to church on Sunday but hangs out in the bar room. Why do you want to go there, preacher? Why do you want to talk about the bar? Well, hold on, let's just stop for a second. Let's talk about the bar room. I mean, it wasn't in my notes, but let's talk about it. This isn't a rules-based church. This is a, you got Jesus and now you're different than the world-based church. When you go to the world, if God is real and he's called his people to be separate, when you go into a barroom, does it look anything like what the people of God are supposed to be involved in? No. The Bible's real clear that you're not to get drunk. The majority of people in barrooms in some way, shape, or form are getting drunk. But not only that, the music that's playing over the airwaves in there. That's right. People don't like it when you start talking about their music. Right. I'm not. That's between you and the Lord. But God has revealed to me the truth about music. The spirit that is behind the music of the world is another spirit other than the Holy Spirit. I've done my research on this. This isn't something that I just slept at a Holiday Inn Express last night and woke up one morning and said, oh, the music of the world is bad. No, I did my research. And it's not all obvious, like, you know, War Pigs, a song that was written by Black Sabbath that says Satan laughing spreads his wings. No, it's not all that obvious, but there was even one song that was on top, the number one some time back, that was called The Compass. And I just kind of reviewed it. I don't have time to listen to all that stuff, so I'm just going to Google it. Sometimes I hear some stuff in the health club, I'm like, oh, that's what they're saying. Okay, I catch on to it like that. But I Googled The Compass, and essentially what the woman that wrote the song said was, the idea was that you just got to follow the lead of your heart. You let your heart lead you and guide you in the direction that feels best for you. Well, there's a problem with that. That's contrary to the word of God. Right. The prophet Jeremiah said, the heart of man is deceitfully wicked above all else. Who can know it? Even the heart and the mind of the old man doesn't even know the wickedness that's in his own heart. He's fallen away from God. If you let your heart be your compass to tell you which direction to go, you're going to find yourself so far away from the presence of God, you're not even going to know how to get back.
Right.
There was one song, it seemed simple, it was a little country song, and I don't remember what the name of it was, but he said, I think I'll sit down on this pier and have myself a beer. The whole point to the story was that his old lady left him and his life was miserable and he was going to fix it by drinking a beer. Well, that might work for about a night, and then you wake up the next morning, you got the same problem. You're never letting God get down to the heart of the issue and deal with the issues that are at hand. And so the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that where the world congregates, the only reason that the believer has any business to be there is if he's being a light in the midst of darkness, salt on the earth. He's there to share the good news with somebody. And I'm not talking about, I've heard stories too about, here's two guys driving down the road and they light up a doobie. And, well, that's what they used to call it back in the old days. And he hands the joint to his friend and his friend takes a hit off the joint. He's like, yeah, dude, remember when we used to go to church, bro? And they're sitting there having a conversation about the things of God. And I'm not trying to say that kind of thing doesn't ever happen and people aren't miserable in their sin, because I believe that it does. But to think that you're going to evangelize somebody in a bar room, I'm not saying this never happened. God's not limited. But that's not God's will for his people to be found in the midst of darkness and in the midst of despair and in the midst of disobedience. But that's what happened to Solomon. Because of that, the kingdom was split. Because of that, the people began. It caused a successive, a progressive movement away from the things of God towards the things of the world. And God began to send the prophets to warn them. And essentially, that's where we are right here. It's, the northern kingdom has already been taken captive by the nation of Assyria. And the southern kingdom now, at the beginning of Isaiah's ministry, was not yet taken, but had not been taken. But during Jeremiah's ministry, they did get taken. And Isaiah was warning against what was going to happen to Judah also, the same thing that had happened to the northern kingdom, Israel. And so this is what God is saying. Comfort ye my people, says your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. This isn't really done yet. He's letting them know that there's going to come a day whenever this trial of your life is going to be over. The trial is temporary. You're going to find yourself in the midst of this captivity, in the midst of this bondage, in the midst of this trial. But I want the prophet to speak. God wants his people in this situation, Israel, to be comforted. They've been through great trial because of their sin. They have been in bondage to their enemy. In a similar fashion, we as the people of God find ourselves experiencing the aftermath of bondage from the enemy because of the sin that has been in our life. The sin of our past that leaves us open for people and circumstances in our lives to create untold sorrow and pain. We often blame the people and the circumstances whenever these things start to take place, but it's the sin the enemy offers, and God allows it to try the hearts of his people. Sometimes people need a little bit more specificity whenever you're talking about things. People's sins sometimes are more obvious than at other times. For instance, we can see the firsthand the results of drugs and alcohol in a person's life. It causes destruction to themselves and everyone around them. Not only them, but their loved ones are left to suffer. And so many times they desire to do better, but left behind them is a trail of broken promises and pain. Pain for spouses, pain for children, pain for parents, loss of love, loss of material possessions. I've seen it before. It happens time and again. But it's not always drugs and alcohol. Sometimes it's relationships that we refuse to let go of. We come to the Lord and we learn his ways and we have relationships that he deals with us about. Sometimes they're romantic, sometimes they're friendly, but we refuse to let go. These relationships pull us from the things of God and further into the world. And before we know it, the trials in our lives are multiplied. There are valleys that we can't get out of, mountains that we can't seem to climb over, crooked places that we can't find our way back from. This has happened to Israel. The result of their sin will bring them far from home. They will no longer be in Israel, but captive in Babylon. But I need you to know that there's always hope for God's people.
Amen.
Amen. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 6 through 7. In Isaiah 40, verses 6 through 7, the voice said, "Cry." And he said, "What shall I cry?" This is what you shall cry. "All flesh is grass, and the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, because the Spirit of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people is grass." I'm going to break it down for you in a second. Just hold on a second. Surely the people is grass. Go to Isaiah 40, verses 15 through 17. "Behold, the nations are as a drop of a bucket." You have a big old bucket of water, you put one little drop in there and it gets lost in the midst of the bigness of the bucket. "Are counted as the small dust of the balance." Can you imagine the balance scales, that how they weighed and measured things back in the old days? A little bit of fine dust on that balance scale. The point is that it makes no difference. It's not going to change the weight in any way. "Behold, he takes up the isles as a very little thing, and Lebanon is not sufficient to burn." You know what Lebanon was famous for? Was the fact that, hold on one second. Lebanon was famous for their cedars. Whenever Solomon built the temple, they imported cedar wood from Lebanon. If you read in the Old Testament, you'll read time and again about the cedars of Lebanon. What this passage of scripture is saying is that there's not enough wood in Lebanon that if you caught the whole thing on fire, sooner or later, the burning would stop. Nor the beast thereof sufficient for a burnt offering. There's not enough animals on the face of the earth to perpetually offer sacrifice unto God. All nations before him are as nothing, and they are counted to him less than nothing and vanity. I wanted to tell you that there's always hope for the child of God because of these two things. Number one, people are like grass and they wither away and they perish. Number two, the people, the powers that be, like in Israel's circumstance, the nations that ruled over them are like a drop in the bucket. There's not enough wood to burn. There's not enough. This earth cannot contain. The idea is that it's temporary. People are temporary. Leadership is temporary. Nations are temporary. Your circumstances are temporary, but the God that you serve is eternal, and you need to understand that. No matter how much pain you're experiencing right here, right now, it's only temporary. But the relationship that you have with God will be eternal, amen? The God that you serve is eternal, hallelujah. And there's going to be one day when you're going to look into his eyes, and you're going to be with him for an eternity. So when you see your circumstances, instead of looking at God through the eyes of your circumstances, you need to look through to your circumstances through the eyes of how big God is. Amen. In a similar fashion, it's important that the child of God know that his circumstances and trials are only temporary. Amen. No matter how painful they may be, they're not going to be here for an eternity. Chapter 40, verse 1 said, "Comfort ye. Comfort ye, my people, says your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her." The word comfort has a lot of different meanings to it, but part of it has the idea of a cleansing breath. Almost as though the weight of the world was on your chest and you couldn't breathe. But part of it also has the idea of being sorry. So there's a repentance element to it. The idea is that there's help on the way, but part of the help, it's in your hands. Because you have to come to the realization of where you went against God. You have to come to the realization of where you ventured out of the way of God. And that part of the problem related to the tribulation and the trial has to do with the choices that you made in the past. Right. Some people say, "But I'm just the victim, preacher." Mm-hmm. "You don't understand. I'm just the victim. I'm the one that, you know, I'm the one that, you know, that's being hurt." Well, hold on a second. I'm not going to sit here and dissect it all. But the truth be told, you're not just the victim. In each and every circumstance, I hope you don't get frustrated with me when I talk this way. I'm just being truthful. In each and every circumstance that we find ourselves in, we're not just in that circumstance based upon the fact that somebody just took advantage of us and put us there. No. We allowed it. We opened up a door and we were part and parcel to it. No matter how, "Yeah, but I didn't know they were going to do that to us." Well, hold on a second. Don't tell me along the way that the Lord didn't give you a check in your spirit.
Right.
And then some people would say, "Yeah, but all this happened before I even knew the Lord." Okay, well, God can restore.
Amen.
God can restore and God can deliver. He still sits on the throne. He can still give you wisdom and lead and guide you. Amen. But part of it has to be, I have to be sorrowful for the way that I've gone against the Lord. And when I do, there's a relief. Hallelujah. There's a burden that's lifted. There's like a deep cleansing breath that's able to comfort ye. And it also has the idea of speaking like a mother would to her child. "Speak to my children, Israel, prophet, but speak to her as a mother would to her child." I don't know if you remember or not, but I can remember being a kid. I mean, I used to have a real soft heart back whenever I was a child. And if I did the least little thing, I can remember that I would just feel so much conviction. I didn't know what it was then, but I believe it was conviction. And there were many times whenever I would go to my mom and I would tell her whatever it was that I had done. And then she would say something simple. "Oh, that's okay, baby. Thanks for telling me." And it was like all of a sudden the burden was lifted. Have you ever been in trouble before? Maybe as even an older person and you The weight of something was lying upon your shoulders, and you just felt like the enemy, boy, when he sees that, he just rushes to it. He'll try to put it, even if you don't know God, he'll oppress you with the circumstance, and he'll cause that weight to be so heavy on your back because he wants you to feel miserable. He wants you to try to find another way out. He wants you to try. But then all of a sudden, something happens, even if it's in the physical. Something happens that gets you out of that deal. All of a sudden, I can breathe again.
Yeah.
God wanted the prophet to speak to Israel and let them know, listen to me, there comes a time when the circumstance is temporary. There comes a time when the situation stops. Speak comfortably to my children Israel. Let them know that part of the hope is in their hands. Because part of the comfort is them realizing and repenting of what got them where they were. You see, even in the beginning, in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 16 through 18, God came to Israel through the prophet Isaiah because of the situation that they were in. This is what he told them in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 16 through 18. He says, "Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do well. Seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow." All of these things are descriptive of a heart of compassion, not a heart of pride and arrogance, right? What can a widow give back to you? What can an orphan give back to you if you help them? Nothing. But a person that helps them has a heart that has been connected to God and realizes that people need help. They're not just walking around in the selfishness of their own life, worried about their own concerns. And whenever you give your heart to the Lord and you repent before God, something happens to your heart and it becomes compassionate towards other people. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You've been around people before that whenever somebody's in a bind, all they ever do is talk about it. It's almost like if they had the opportunity, or at least the way they talk about it behind their back, they just press them in a little bit more. Oh, yeah, look at what old boys into. Look at what old girls into. And they just press them in a little bit more. No heart of compassion. No realization that they themselves could also be found in the same situation. This is what the Lord goes on to say. "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." Wool is white. God wants to let people know that there is a problem called sin, but guess what? He has an answer for it. Amen. He brings deliverance. He brings purity. It's the purity of Jesus, the shedding of his blood, the forgiveness of the sin that allows us to be in right relationship with God. We're talking about renewal. We're talking about being comforted. The word of God says in Acts chapter 3, verse 19, it says, "Repent ye therefore, be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." That word refreshing, again, a recovery of breath, a revival. The idea, once again, is that it's like I'm unloading. You know what I'm saying? I'm unloading to the Lord. I'm saying, listen to me. If you focus on what everybody else is around you is doing, whether it be the person that you're closest to, whether it be people that you work with, if you focus on everything everybody else is doing around you and all the wrong that they're doing, and you never Amen. Focus internally and realize what's going on with you, Amen. You're never going to come to the place where you unburden yourself of the very thing that's plaguing you. You need to bring that to the Lord. You need to repent of it. And there's refreshing that comes, a recovery of breath, a revival of life from the dead to the living. We need to come to the realization of our own failures Amen. Before God. Amen. And make them right before the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Release from the burden requires coming to the end of self. There is something that the pain of the past will do to a person. Even the strongest of men grow weary, and weariness can allow the strength of God to be revealed to them, so that through their own revelation of their weariness, they will also gain a revelation of his glory. He desires that they gain a revelation of their weakness, so they can gain a revelation of his rescue.
Right.
Amen. It's not his desire that the people he loves and created suffer and feel the pain of trial and tribulation, but the heart of man is proud and resistant to the voice of God. Therefore, he must allow it to be revealed to them that they are weak, They are contrary to his will and in need of his deliverance. God, you may not like this. This may not be the picture of God that you desire to hear. But God wants to prove to us that we are weak in our own strength. He will not share his glory with another. I don't care how proud you are. I don't care how strong you are. I don't care what you've been raised, how your daddy spoke to you, what he tried to convince you of. I don't care how strong you are in the physical. I don't care how smart you are intellectually. The truth to be told, God wants you to come to the realization that without him, you are weak.
Amen.
The nation of Israel was a proud people. They knew that they were the people of God, and while they themselves had fallen into idolatrous sin with the people and gods of the other nations, they looked at their heritage and viewed themselves superior to others, and that they knew the true God and others didn't. They knew him but lived in disobedience towards him. Therefore, they were hypocritical in their hearts. They were judgmental of others but couldn't see the fault in their own lives. Amen. They desired to see others destroyed while they didn't even realize that they were being destroyed because of their disobedience against God. The human heart is still plagued with this problem. People sit in churches all over the world and they view what they perceive to be the faults and failures of others, and they compare the faults and failures of others to their own lives, and they judge their lives in comparison to the lives of others, and they judge the hearts of others proudly while never considering the condition of their own heart. God will try the heart. He will weary the proud. He will reveal to the hearts and minds of men that they are filled with scarlet sin. But he will also reveal that his strength and power sends deliverance. But if the heart will never allow itself to grow weary, if it remains proud and it will never realize that it's lost, and it will never realize that God has a way out, many will never make it over the mountain. Many will never climb out of the valley. Many will never find their way back home from the crooked path. This next passage of scripture was spoken through Isaiah to Israel at a time when they were lost and things looked hopeless for them. But the true fulfillment of the passage spoke of the time when Jesus would come. It promised that John the Baptist would come and he would make the way. He would lead the way for Jesus. So there's an immediate context where Israel is in bondage and God's going to deliver them. And he did. There was a time of deliverance for them. They were able to go back home. They were able to rebuild their temple. They were able to reinstitute the sacrifice and worship God for a period of time. But the ultimate fulfillment of this passage happened when Jesus showed up. In Isaiah 40, verses 3 through 5. The scripture says, "The voice of him that cries in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." Amen. Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 3 says that in those days John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." And so what we need to understand is that those times in our past that resulted in pain from sinful choices we made ultimately prepared a way in our hearts to be receptive to the coming King. I've said this many times before as I've preached this passage before, that when it talked about the fact that John the Baptist was a messenger preparing a way for the way, the word way in the New Testament there is hadas. It means the pathway. It means a path that's clearly discernible. You know, back in the day, whenever I was a kid, I've used this analogy before, when we'd walk in the woods, sometimes all of a sudden we'd find this heavily traveled path. It's obvious. People were going from point A to point B. It was clearly discerned. The weeds hadn't overgrown it. Y'all know what I'm talking about back when y'all were boys and y'all used to hang out in the woods. Look at that path. Let's see where that thing goes. But by the time that Jesus showed up on the scene, the pathway was muddied. It was obscured. It had been overgrown by weeds. Why? Because religion had stood in the way of the plan of God. The religious leaders had muddied the waters. Religion still today muddies the waters. It makes it difficult for people to be able to discern the right way. Preachers have their own agenda. They get up and they preach a message that's going to make people feel comfortable so that they'll keep coming back to church next week. That's not the way of the Lord. The way of the Lord says there's one way to the presence of the Father. It's through the shed blood of the Son, Jesus. Faith in that and allowing the Holy Spirit to change us on the inside is the only thing that's going to make us in right relationship with God and continue to cleanse us of all unrighteousness each and every day as we continue to walk with God.
Amen.
The sinful choices that we made ultimately prepare a way in our hearts to be receptive to the King. So back in the Old Testament, in this passage, they would send a messenger ahead of the King. Make sure that there weren't any mountains in the way or valleys in the way, that crooked places that were going to prevent the navigation of the King to get to the place where he was going. Spiritually speaking, there's spiritual mountains and valleys, crooked places that have been part of the past. But truth be told, all of these, they start to make us weary. The climbing of the spiritual mountain, the trying to get out of the spiritual valley, the trying to find a way home from the crooked path that we took. All these things begin to wear down on the human mind, on the human heart, begin to weary him, begin to weaken him, but at the same time, preparing him to be receptive for the King. Preparing him and bringing him to a place where his pride is being broken to where he will be ready for the arrival of the King. Scripture says, this is where we started in Isaiah 40, verses 29 through 31. He gives power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with the wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Once again, I titled this morning's message, Wings for the Weary. The scripture says, they that wait on the Lord. The idea of waiting isn't just me sitting around twiddling my thumbs and not doing anything. The idea of waiting is me looking hopefully and intent on the Lord, even in the midst of my circumstances, even in the midst of my situation, no matter what it is that I'm going through, I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm waiting on Him and I'm trusting in Him that He's going to be able to get me through, that He's going to show up for my rescue. And like I told you earlier, even if it never happens on this earth, I believe that it will. And I'm about to get to a passage that will show that God does want to rescue us on earth. But even if it doesn't, like that passage talked about, the people are like the grass and they wither. The nations are like a drop in a bucket. What it means is that circumstances that appear to be created by people, things that have their place upon this earth are all temporary. God is eternal, amen. And no situation that you are facing is going to outlast your relationship with God. Hallelujah. They that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength.
Amen.
If you will hold on to the Lord, no matter what it is that you're facing and going through,
amen,
God will, He's going to give you wings like eagles. What does that mean? That means that your situation may not change today.
That's right.
It might not change tomorrow. You want me to be a lying preacher and tell you that everything on this earth is going to go the way you want it? I'm not going to tell you that. That's what a lot of the Word of Faith preachers would preach. Even the people that are on much of the Christian television. Oh, if you find yourself in trial and tribulation, you just don't have enough faith. That's a lying gospel.
Yeah.
Paul lost his head for the kingdom of God. Peter was crucified according to church tradition upside down. Mark was drugged behind a chariot through the streets of Egypt. Thomas was run through with a Brahmin Indian sword, all because they refused to relinquish the fact that Jesus died on a cross and rose again on the third day, and that same Jesus was living in their heart. They refused to give up on that truth. They held on to it to the very end. And what I'm here to try to tell you is this. This earth is not your home.
Amen.
Amen.
This place isn't your home. We preached it last week, I believe it was. We're a pilgrim.
Yes.
And we're passing through. We're on a journey. A sojourn. Amen.
Yes.
And this is not the end of the story.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
He's the one. So your situation may not change. You got the wings, but God will give you wings of an eagle. Amen. He will give you the wings of an eagle, and while your situation may not change, He will allow you to soar above it. While the trial and tribulation you may still be facing, He will allow you to soar above it. It's the same idea as He brings a peace that surpasses understanding. That's what the Word of God says in the book of Philippians. He brings a peace that surpasses understanding. What does that mean, preacher? It means your situation may not have changed, but all of a sudden, He breathes peace.
Yes.
He breathes peace.
Yes.
And you can feel it. The peace of God is something palpable. You can feel it.
Yes.
One minute there's chaos and there's anxiety, and the next minute, peace and rest.
Yes.
The presence of God. Amen. Amen. He shows up. And when He does it, you know it's Him. It's not a word a preacher spoke to you, it's a word the Lord spoke to you.
Amen.
God's presence will show up. Point number one that I want to make with this is that even the proudest of hearts, the strongest of people, grow weary. That's what it said in that passage of scripture right there that we were just reading. It says, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. It doesn't matter how young they are. It doesn't matter how strong they are. It doesn't matter how prideful they are. Standing in their own strength, even the proudest and the strongest will fall and fail the Lord. God will deem it to be so. And once again, God wants His glory to be elevated, not man's glory.
Right.
God wants you and I to realize that separate from Him, we can't do it. I'm telling you, man, all of my life, my dad tried to convince me. He would tell me things like, son, you need to pull yourself up by the bootstraps. Son, you need to get this thing done. And I thank my dad for his hard work ethic. I thank my dad for his toughness. I mean, he was a tough dude. And it works in the physical world to some extent. What I mean is that when I wake up in the morning, I got a little diarrhea, guess what? I'm still going to work.
Yeah,
if I'm a little bit nauseated, I'm still going to work. Even if I got a fever, I'm still going to work unless my boss says you're going to get the kids sick, so you need to stay home. But he probably ain't going to tell me that. He said, put a mask on your face. But the point that I'm trying to, and all that's good. We need a little bit of perseverance in our life. Amen. Too many people are quitters nowadays.
Amen.
But at the same time, when it comes to spiritual things, if you think you're going to muscle up and pull yourself up by the bootstraps, no. True strength comes when we learn how to become dependent upon the Lord.
Right.
And it's a hard thing to recognize the fact that I got to let go and surrender to God. Especially when all my life I've been trained to hold on, to fight, to scratch, to claw, to never give up or to quit. Spiritually speaking, I got to be able to get to the place of surrender. Get down on my knees and say, Lord, I surrender to You. Lord, I give in to You. Lord, I realize You're my strength and my hope, and I can't go on. The heart that's willing to humble itself and come to that place will get a revelation of how strong God is. In Leviticus chapter 26 through 14 through 20, it says, this is whenever the Lord's about to bring Israel into the, well, not really about to, but He's preparing them ahead of time when He's going to bring them into the promised land. They've been wandering in the wilderness. And He says, but if you will not hearken unto Me, in other words, when I bring you to this place, if you don't listen to Me, and will not do all these commandments, and if you shall despise My statutes, or if your soul abhors My judgments. I can remember a time, I don't mean to go off too much, but I remember a time when my heart really wasn't right with the Lord. And I was sitting in churches. And I would sit here and I would watch some people worship the Lord. I don't mean to pick on Aaron, but I can remember him up at the front jumping up. He's 6'5", and he looked like he was touching the ceiling over there at Cornerstone Ministries. And my heart was hard. And I was like, what's he so happy about? Or, you know, somebody's sitting there praying. And I'm like, boy, I wish this prayer would get over so I get out of here. What was I even doing in church? Why was I even wasting my time? He says, if your soul abhors My judgments and My statutes, if your soul loathes My word. When you hear the word of God and it's contrary to something in your life, if you abhor it, in other words, if it's not like sitting right with you, there's something wrong with your heart. What are you trying to say, preacher? Are you perfect? No. What I'm trying to say is that even though there's things in my life, when I get to the word and it rebukes me in it, I know it's the word of the Lord. I know he's right and I know I'm wrong. And he's just trying to make me right and to line up with him. Amen. Hallelujah. That's what the word of God does. It reveals ourselves to ourselves and it gives us an opportunity to make things right with the Lord. He says, if your soul abhors my judgment so that you will not do all my commandments, but that you break my covenant, I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, the burning ague, that's a fever, sickness, that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart. You shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies, that they hate you, shall reign over you, and you shall flee when none pursues you. And if you will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you 7 times more for your sins, and I will break the pride of your power. God will break the pride of our power. Listen to me. The God that we serve scattered the stars in the sky and breathed life into a lump of clay named Adam. He can cause, he goes on to say right here, if I'm not mistaken, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass. You know what that means? Heaven, iron. People used to talk that it just meant prayers, that your prayers don't make it to heaven. Really what it's talking about, see, Israel was an agrarian society. They required the rains. Egypt was different. They required the inundation of the Nile River, and that caused the delta of the Egyptian soil. It would flood, then it would come back in, and they would be able to plant their crops. But Israel required the rains, the former and the latter rains. God says, I'll make your heaven iron. There ain't no rains gonna fall. I'm gonna make your earth brass. There's not gonna be a harvest. And if you had a harvest, your enemy's gonna steal it. The point that I'm trying to make is the God that you serve is the maker of heaven and earth and all that in them is. He's the one that can cause your prosperity to come, and he can also put a hole in your pocket. Amen. The Lord can take away your material possessions. Okay. The Lord can cause things to become contrary in your life. The Lord knows how to bless, and he also knows how to take away. When he takes away, it's not because he's just trying to punish you. No, he's not just trying to punish me. He's trying to give us a revelation. He's trying to make us understand. He's trying to break down our pride. He's trying to cause us to come to the place where we realize that in and of our own strength, we're weak. And he allows us to become weary so that our hearts will become receptive to his truth and the accepting of his plan. In this passage, long before Israel ever failed God, he warned them that if they refused to hear his counsel, that he would turn his face from them, and the result would be that they would expend their strength in vain. No matter how strong a man may think he is, no matter how wonderful his plans may be, God knows how to break the pride of their power. You say, but there are many that move forward in life and only gain more and more, and their power and their pride is never broken by God. I would tell you that that's even a worst case scenario.
Right.
Because what that means is that they never knew God, they didn't recognize him, and he never recognized them. God is faithful to work in the hearts Amen. Of his people. And sometimes what we look at as a trial in our life is the greatest blessing of all.
Yeah.
You know, a good father is going to correct his children. I mean, I know that I tried my best to do it. I'm sure that there's many a time that I made plenty of mistakes. But my kids will never be able to say that I didn't try to correct them. And I didn't just whoop them. I whooped them, but I didn't just whoop them. I would sit them down, and they know it to be true, and I would take a lot of time to instruct them. This is where we went wrong. And we've already explained this many a times. See, if I don't instruct you in the way that you should go, that's what the Lord revealed to me. Maybe this is a parenting 101, but maybe you'll have a kid one day. This is what the Lord revealed to me. As I prayed, I said, God, I need your wisdom. Because I'll ruin these kids. If I'm left to myself, I will ruin these kids. The Lord showed me, he said, a couple of things. Number one, he said, you're real good at that discipline stuff, but you don't have much mercy. If I didn't have mercy on you, where would you be? That sat home. And number two, my word speaks a whole lot more about instruction than it does discipline. If you don't instruct your children in the way they should go, you have failed them as a father. So what the Lord revealed to me was that I was supposed to instruct my children before I disciplined my children. So I therefore, from that day moving forward, I would do my best to try to instruct them. Whether it was at 18 months, having a conversation with them. Whether they understood it or not, it doesn't matter. I was practicing for myself. Mm-hmm. And they understand a whole lot more than you give them credit for. And what my kids would be able to tell you is this, is that many times under rare circumstances, maybe not, But the times that they did get spanking, it was because they had done something that they had already been instructed that they were not to do. And they understood cognitively, intellectually, they knew that they were transgressing what had already been taught to them. Once you cross over that boundary, that's what you call rebellion. And if you allow rebellion to breed in your home, you're going to have a mess, because now your child is going to be in charge of the house instead of you being in charge of the house. That's what God does through His Word. He teaches us. He instructs us in His ways. But then when we venture past that, once we understand it, we're now in rebellion against God. God will allow trial and tribulation. He will allow chastisement to take place in the life of the people. So I'm going back to the fact of this. God's people, whenever you look at people that continue to flourish, and even though they haven't paid attention to God, that's even a worst case scenario, because that means that they never recognize God and God never recognized them. The third, this point number two, He gives power to those who have nothing left. Amen. The scripture says in Isaiah 40:29, He gives power to the faint, and to them that have no might, He increases strength. You can go to Daniel chapter 4, verses 20 through 22. But I just want to kind of tell you a little bit about this story. We're about to close. But in Daniel chapter 4, Daniel, if you'll remember the story, this is a map of Israel, a crude map of Israel. Israel is this piece of land here. There were two other rivers, Tigris and Euphrates. This is the land of Babylon over here to the east. And the children of Israel are from Jerusalem. Daniel was one of them. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were taken from Jerusalem and brought to Babylon. And I did a little research one time, and I think I've shared that before. It's about the distance from home to San Antonio. They walked it. And they now were imprisoned over there, but God elevated Daniel and brought him to some elevated places. And he was a seer of, he was an interpreter of dreams. Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon at the time, and he was the one that brought those people into captivity. But God wanted to show Nebuchadnezzar who, for lack of better words, who the boss was. He gave Nebuchadnezzar a dream, and in the dream there was a tree. And this tree grew all the way up to the heavens. In other words, the idea behind that is that even God took notice of it, just like He took notice of the Tower of Babel. The tree grew all the way to the heavens, and the branches spread out to where it provided shade and fruit and leaves for all the beasts of the field. This tree was so big that people were eating off of, being fed by its prosperity. But then there was a watcher, which is another word for an angel, that said, cut the tree down, but leave the stump. Leave the stump, which is an idea that is going to revive again one day. Leave the stump, but allow that king, that kingdom, if you will, to be like a beast. Let it be like a beast where the dew of the heavens rests upon it. And so he doesn't know what the dream means. He comes to Daniel. Daniel says, well, that's you, king. That's your kingdom. Your kingdom's like a big old tree. It reaches all the way up to heaven. You're so powerful, you're so rich, you're so mighty, you have all of this stuff going on. Then the scripture says right here, and that's what it says in Daniel chapter 4, verses 20 through 22, the tree that thou sawest, which grew and was strong, whose height reached unto the heaven, and the sight thereof to all the earth, whose leaves were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and in it was meat or food for all, under which the beasts of the field dwelt, and upon whose branches the fowls of the heaven and their habitation. It is thou. In other words, it's you, O king. You are grown and become strong, for your greatness is grown and reaches unto heaven, and thy dominion to the end of the earth. In verse 25, it says, goes on to tell another part of the dream, that they shall drive thee from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make thee to eat grass as oxen. They shall wet thee with the dew of heaven, and seven times shall pass over thee, till thou know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomsoever He will. God wanted Nebuchadnezzar to know who the God was and who the man was. And basically what's happening is that God took his mind away. That's what ended up happening in this situation. He struck him with insanity is what took place for a 7-year period. The scripture says in verses 28 through 30, all this came upon the king Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spoke and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? He's lifted up in his heart. He's full of pride. He's full of arrogance. He doesn't recognize God or the things of God. It says right here, what I put right here in these verses is at the end. See, part of the plan of God, in the end, it brings restoration. When you find yourself, when you have nothing left, instead of blaming God and feeling like God forsook you, it's now time to realize that at the end, God wants to restore you. God wants to bring you to a place where he can elevate you, pick you back up, and restore you. But he's breaking down the pride. He will not share his glory with another. He's revealed, he's instructed, and now it was time to discipline. But then there comes a time when the discipline is over. Verses 33 through 37. The same hour was the thing fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from men. He did eat grass as oxen. His body was wet with the dew of heaven, till his hairs were grown like eagle feathers and his nails like bird's claws. At the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up mine eyes into heaven, and my understanding returned unto me. I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him that lives forever, whose dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation. And all the inhabitants of the earth that are reputed as nothing, and he does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say unto him, what doest thou? At the same time, my reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom, my honor and brightness returned unto me, and my counselors and my lords sought unto me. And I was established in my kingdom, and excellent majesty was added unto me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the kingdom of heaven, all whose works are truth, and his ways judgment, and those that walk in pride, he is able to abase, which means he's able to humble them. God is able to bring the high and mighty low, no matter who, how strong they think that they are. Point number two, once again, was he gives power to those who have nothing left. See, that's what happens. The first part of that is that in the end of the situation, there's restoration. Amen. But also I want you to know that he brings grace and strength to those who have nothing left, who realize, who have been humble. We used this scripture last week, 2 Corinthians 12, 9 through 10. The Apostle Paul, because of the trial and tribulation that was in his life, he asked the Lord to remove it from him three different times. But this is what the Lord responded. He said unto me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. It's the complete opposite of the physical world. In the physical world, if you're strong, you can get some things accomplished. But in the spiritual world, you have to lower yourself, humble yourself in the eyes of God. And when you do, he's able to trust you and give strength to you. Amen. Lastly, number three, he will renew the weary. It says that in verse 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. The word renew literally means to change. It means to change, to sprout again, to grow. It's like a revival of the heart. It's like almost like a change of clothes, an exchanging of old garments for new ones, where we exchange our weakness for his power. Amen. God has glory, and he desires to reveal it to us. And many times the way that he does it is through showing us our own weakness. I'm closing with this last scripture, Philippians chapter 4, verses 11 through 13. This is the Apostle Paul. He says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. The Apostle Paul says that no matter what I'm going through, no matter whether I have a lot, no matter whether I have a little, I know how to be content in the things of God. He says, I know both how to be abased, which means to be humbled. I know how to abound everywhere, and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. I titled this morning's message, Wings for the Weary, because I just wanted you to know that once again, you might be going through some things. Maybe life's just clipping along faster than what you ever expected and you don't have time to breathe. You feel as though you've put God on the back burner. I'm here to tell you. Or maybe that's even worse than that and there's other things going on in your life. You know your personal situation, but I'm here to tell you that God allows things to happen in the lives of His people. He wants to bring them lower so that they'll put their eyes on Him so that He can return with grace and favor and strength.